Well, why do we need radio? Well, basically, you need radio to replace this. So I've been using a very old schematic of a telegraph, basically. You want to replace this by this. As simple as that. You want to get rid of the wire, okay? And in fact, that was the first application of radio, replacing the wire. By the way, a small story. In fact, the first big transmitters have been established in France, like the transmitter of the station of Lafayette in Bordeaux, the Lyon-Ladoux station in Lyon, and Saint-Assise in Paris. And the reason for that is that France had not been involved in the cable in the ocean. So in fact, France and Germany were dependent on Americans and English to transmit vital and very strategic information. So that's why those two countries, particularly France, have been the first establishing big transmitters so that they could communicate with a replacement for cable, strategic information to colonies, to other countries, etc., etc. So that's quite funny to remind that. Okay, where do we find radio in our life? I'm sure that the one which is on your left, you know it. That's the first thing you are thinking about when you refer to radio. The radio of your grandmother or your grandfather. I'm not sure a lot of people still have such radio. Are there some people having that still in their home? You are an old woman? Okay, so that's basically started in the families and so on, in the 20s, 30s, that was really the beginning. The golden age is probably the 30s and the 50s. That's where a bunch of family radio were sold. The TV started quite early. This one is a modern TV. But in fact, the first experiment for TV, it's in the 30s. Even before on wires, by the way, transmission of TV over wires is, guess when, before the beginning of the 20th century, at the end of the 19th century. But the TV over radio has been developed in 30, 35. They were reusing the broadcast transmitter, and they were using the audio channel to transmit a very strange noise, which when applied to the screen, you could see a very bad image, very low resolution image, but it was the first TV experiment. So TV, indeed, satellite TV in the 80s, so that's, I guess, the three most obvious applications of radio. But indeed, there are some others. One of the first users of radio is transportation, basically. Aircraft with radar. The radar is from 1904. It's quite old invention, in fact. You see the Titanic, which is sinking. Okay, yes. Aviation in the 20s. The railway also have been using radio quite early in the 20s, 30s. On your left, you can see, you have an idea of what could be the station on the Titanic, for instance, or whatever big ship at the beginning of the 20th century. It was indeed only telegraphy, no radio telephony, only telegraphy. And the goal of the radio, there were two main purposes for the radio on the ships. It was transmitting the telegram from the people, and they paid a lot of money to transmit information, that's nice, the cruise is wonderful, whatever. They were rich people, so they had a lot of money. But it was also for a safety reason. If the boat had a problem, you could transmit over radio. And in fact, the Titanic date is quite important because they did not have any sensit, as you can see. He is looking for a sensit. don't have any sense it. But no, more seriously, because before 1912, which is the big catastrophe of Titanic, the usage of radio on ship was not mandatory. And this catastrophe made people realize that it was extremely important. And after 1912, the first big meeting of the ITU, so the International Organization for Telecommunication, has been focusing on radio, and that's the date where they established the first code of conduct and laws and etc. for transportation, and particularly naval transportation. Other usage, well, indeed, very quickly, it started. One of the first usage was the strategic communication, but also strategic or scientific, but also strategic instruments. I'm going to explain. So one of the first well-known place for radio has been the Tour Eiffel. In fact, the Tour Eiffel has been, I would say, saved by radio. Otherwise, they had to get rid of it. So Eiffel succeeded to keep the Tour Eiffel where it is, using the radio as a pretext. I don't know what we'd say in English, but and I talked about Bordeaux Lafayette, Saint-Assise, typically. So they were big stations with huge antenna transmitting at very low frequency, most of the time below 100 kilohertz. If not few tens of kilohertz, so it was very low frequency, so huge antennas, okay, completely different from what you know in your life. And there are some scientific but potentially also strategic instruments. So you see the Arecibo antenna, which is one of the biggest, not paraboloid, it's a spheric antenna, it's not a parabole. For instance, you also have the well-known Chernobyl 2, which is the Russian Duga 3 transmitter, which has been a very strange transmitter. We don't completely know what was the usage. It was probably oversea radar, but also potentially other usage, military and very strange usage. And in fact, you can see that now China has been realizing this device, which is this system, which is the biggest spherical antenna. It's even bigger than Arecibo. It's used for radio astronomy, but indeed not only. It's also used for other usage. You have also the ARP system in the US, etc. So it's indeed used for strategic usage. Well, as we are talking about strategy, indeed the two World War have been very important for the development of radio. So first World War in the aircraft in the 30s and during the Second World War. It has been a huge development for mobile and portable telephony. Well, it's not your portable, it's not your phone, but it's still portable telephony. The radar invention also. So you see a nice animation of what is a radar, basically sending a wave, and the wave is reflected, and you measure the time, the travel time from the antenna to the aircraft and back to the antenna, etc., etc. Okay. What else? Well, that's closer, I would say, from your life. So indeed, the modern personal communication. The modern personal communication starting after the Second World War, basically. It was not really cellular telephony, but it could be called personal or mobile personal telephony or private mobile telephony, private mobile radio, whatever. And the first cell phone, as I said, in the 80s. Your best friend, so in the end of the 90s and so on. It's also Bluetooth, it's also Wi-Fi. And talking about Wi-Fi, the first network for data transmission between computers was basically the AlohaNet in 1971. And we are today at the Wi-Fi 802.11AF, which is, I guess, the last, I suppose it's the last specification for Wi-Fi. So you, most of you have all of this, or at least all of the below line. So you all have a phone, you might all have a Bluetooth maybe a device, and you all have a Wi-Fi at home and at work. But radio is also used for hobbies, leisure, okay? So the walkie-talkies, also the walkie-talkies for kids, okay? The citizen band, which has been a huge market. It has really been a huge market. Now it's most of it is abandoned, but there are still some enthusiasts, but it's no longer the big movement that was in the 50s up to the 90s. The toys are using radio, remote control, etc. Amateur radio. For the single guys, I can tell you that Anna Graziella is still the, I think she's still not married. If you want, I can present her to you, no problem. And you can see that there were some ladies practicing radio amateurism. But radio is also used for this. So all the industrial application or and very often a lot of people forget that this is radio. For instance, the microwave oven, it's a radio application. You see here why it's used for reheating materials. It's because it's applying vibration to the molecules, particularly the water molecules. Well, you probably know the speed control application, most of you. Anti-swept or RF tag, and indeed, all the remote control application, telematics, and very recently, IoT. Okay, now we go, after talking about application, we are going to be a little bit more focusing on, well, what are radio waves? Very basic, I'm not going to go into the Maxwell equation, but for those who are newbies, some of you might know about the fundamentals of radio, but for the newbies, I think it's important to go back to that. In fact, what is a wave, by the way? A wave, it's not a movement. There is no movement of material. And particularly, if you take the very good analogy of the water, of the waves in water, which is basically this, okay? You might all have been have done the experiment of throwing away a stone in the water, and in fact, the way it works is that you apply a disturbance at a point, which is this vertical movement, which is an oscillation. So when it's a stone, it's a single pulse. But you could imagine having a device, a mechanical device, applying a vertical oscillation, which most of the time is a sinusoidal oscillation because it's the most natural movement for oscillation. And what you do is not, there is no movement of water. The water is not going away from the focal point. But what you do is that you propagate the oscillation over the space, which is here a surface for the water. So basically, if we take a point, oh, that's good, I have this device, which is very practical. If you take this point, so that's the focal point where the pressure is applied, okay? If you take whatever point, for instance, this one, in fact, it's submitted to the initial movement, which is vertical, which is the movement of oscillation, but there is no movement towards the propagation direction. A lot of people believe that the water is going this way. No. The water is absolutely static regarding the direction of propagation. It's just submitted to the perturbation of the waves. It's exactly the same for the radio, in fact. Indeed, there is no movement, except maybe photon, if you take the theory of the photonic theory. But from a pure electromagnetic standpoint, there is no movement of fields. It's just that locally, your magnetic and electrical state is modified by a signal, which is a signal of modification of the state, which has been initiated by something. And this something, so that's the explanation basically I just gave. This something, most of the time, is due to an electrical disturbance, wanted or not, but an electrical disturbance. So you have a device where the electrons are no longer static, but not only no longer static, because they might move because of a DC current. If you have a DC current, you won't have any propagation of electromagnetic wave. But if this DC current is modified, or if a static state of electrons or charges is modified suddenly, you create a wave. So each time you modify an electrical state, okay, you produce waves. In that case, you have an example of an antenna, which is a half dipole. It's the case of a dipole where you have vibration of electrons. So basically, you establish a current, a sinusoidal current within the antenna. And this is this event which is creating waves. And in fact, when I'm saying that whatever modification, whatever change in the electrical state produce a wave, that's particularly the case for this, which is the lightning during a storm. Basically, this is a powerful transmitter. Why? Because, in fact, it's exactly what I'm describing. So you have a brutal change in the electrical state. So basically, here you have a discharge. You are discharging the cloud to the earth, or vice versa. It depends. So you establish a big burst of current. And because of this burst of current, you create an electromagnetic wave, which is, I can tell you, propagating quite far. I don't know if you know, but in fact, depending on the frequency you are at which you are monitoring storms, you can listen to storms at the opposite of the Earth. Okay? Indeed, very often when if you are still listening to long waves or medium waves during a storm, you hear those what we call statics or parasitics due to the lightnings. But in fact, with a proper receiver, the propagation is much, much farther than that. And in fact, at low frequency, very low frequency, around a few tens of hertz or hundreds, well, kilohertz maximum, lightnings are propagating waves up to all over the Earth, basically. So when you have a storm somewhere, a big storm somewhere on a location on Earth, you can detect it almost wherever on Earth. Indeed, this generator not being, as we are going to see later, a sinusoidal generator, for those who know what is a sinusoid, we'll see that later on, there is no specific frequency. It's a big mess, what we are transmitting. I will come back on that. And in fact, the first transmitters, as maybe some of you know, were spark transmitters. So they were using discharge, brutal discharge, discharge of current within a spark gap to establish some kind of oscillation. Okay. Indeed, I'm going to make so an experiment of the spark transmitter. My experiment is much, much simplified compared to those, I would say, commercial devices at the beginning of the 20th century. They were a little bit more efficient than my transmitter that I'm going to show you, but they were not very good transmitter indeed. Those transmitters were making a lot of noise, a lot of parasitics. Okay, so let's make one. What do we do? We have, in fact, this schematic. So basically, we have a resistor. The resistor is just there, so a battery, which is the power supply. Okay. The resistor is just there to avoid the power supply to go crazy, basically, because each time I'm creating a spark, there is a lot of current, and the power supply might not be happy with that. So that's the only reason for the resistor. But the most important parts are the key, which is going to create, establish the current or switch off the current, and then creating the spark in the gap. Because in fact, as you, some of you might know, when you establish a current, you accumulate magnetic energy in the coil, okay? And indeed, when you open the key, the energy which is within the coil has to escape. So basically, we say that the coil try to avoid the current from being cut. And doing this, it is going to exchange energy with the capacitor. And because of this schematic of a coil in parallel with the capacitor, you have an oscillation. So the energy which is accumulated in the solenoid is being transformed into a kind of oscillation. It's not a very clean oscillation, to be honest, but it's an oscillation anyway. We can make the experiment. So to do that, to demonstrate that, yes, it's working. By the way, that's the noise that a car or a motorbike are doing in the street because of the spark the ignitate the cylinders. Okay. It's also the noise you might have in a receiver because you start an electrical motor. The noise you might have because you are switching the light on. When you switch the light on, if you are listening to a medium wave or long wave, even sometimes in the TV, you are looking at it. Even the digital TV. You are looking at the digital TV, the picture is nice, and somebody is switching off or switching on the light, and then your image might be disturbed during 1 second because, in fact, the receiver has been impacted by a wave created by the action of cutting or establishing the current. So to do that, we are going to use this receiver that a lot of you know, which is the Transfox, so basically the SDR receiver, the Sigfox SDR receiver. So for this, I need to do this, unfortunately. And what I'm going to do is that I'm tuning the receiver somewhere where I suspect, because I made the test before, I suspect that I might hear something. And we're going to put some noise. Okay. Okay. You see here an indication of what is seen in this window. So basically, I'm using a three kilohertz window to listen in a region of a spectrum what is going to happen. Okay, and the energy that is going to be received in this window is basically represented by this monitoring device. We will come back on this one, by the way, later on with a little bit more serious experiment. Anyway, just here, just be pay attention to noise, in fact. So I have my transmitter and I have my key. My key is it's a fly. That's the name. Une lime, c'est fly. I guess it is. I'm not sure. And the advantage of it is that you are creating a series of sparks. I guess you see it. Do you see the sparks? Okay. No? Yes? No? Okay. And with a certain delay because of the software-defined radio and the processing, the computer processing, you can hear a noise which is correlated to my action. If I'm doing this, you hear a kind of pop each time I'm establishing and disengaging the current. Okay? In fact, we could also try to play, or maybe somebody can come here. Laurence. There is the cap, in fact, is a trimming cap. So we can trim the value of the cap. Okay? And we're going to see if trimming the cap, we have more or less noise. There is less. It's better there. Okay? So you see that we have a very, it's not a very sharp tuning, indeed, but there is a kind of tuning. We see that for a certain tuning, we are hearing a little bit more noise at 5 megahertz. We would go to 4 megahertz, we're going to try. Maybe the position of the cap would be different. Let's try. I hope it is going to work. If it does not work. Okay, so. You see, it's working even better. But to do that, you've changed a little bit the position. In fact, by the way, you have increased the cap. Okay? I don't know if you see it, maybe not all of you, but in fact, we have increased the surface of the cap by sliding in the rotor into the stator. Okay? Try to tune it a bit. Yeah. That's the maximum. So we've tuned the transmitter on 4 megahertz. Okay? Nice. Well, it can probably be used to transmit an SOS. SOS. So it works. Don't ask me at what distance it is working. I don't know. But I would have a big antenna at 4 megahertz. Probably it could work at, it could range at a few hundreds of kilometers. Maybe not few hundreds, maybe at least 100 or 200 kilometers. This stuff with a good antenna. But we will come back on antenna. Don't worry. So back to the presentation. And removing this noise. Indeed, not starting on the right slide, but we're going to retry it. Here it is. Okay. I've been saying that this transmitter is probably not a very nice and good transmitter from a selectivity standpoint, a noise standpoint, and so on. In fact, the real start of modern communication, modern radio communication, has been given by the oscillator. That's the fundamental block, in fact, for radio. And to have oscillator, you needed an amplification device. So that's why, in fact, to me, real radio started after 1906, after the invention of the tube, because that's the tube that allowed engineers to build RF oscillators, which are producing sinusoidal wave, which are much, much cleaner than what we've seen. So basically, a transmitter is nothing more than, in fact, an oscillator providing energy to the antenna, and we will come back on the antenna. If you compare the waves and the spectrum, that's about it. Okay, the spark bug, I would could call that way, is a series of pulse with more or less a central frequency. We've been hearing that we had noise, we could tune the noise at a given frequency, but in fact we would have tuned the receiver on a slightly different frequency, we would still have heard the noise. In fact, the selectivity is very fuzzy. Very fuzzy. There is a selectivity, but very, very fuzzy. Okay, and that's because there is a lot of imperfection in the generation, and in fact, it's producing this kind of spectrum with a lot of harmonics and with a lot of spurious. Those of you who made mathematics and electrical engineering know that, in fact, the sinusoidal waveform in the time domain is giving a clean, almost clean, because you might still have some harmonics, but gives a quite clean Dirac of energy in spectrum. So basically, it's much, much more selective. Then the energy is no longer spread over a given spectrum. It's really concentrated at very, very fine and precise frequency. Well, an oscillator, that's no more than that. And in fact, this is a typical Colpitts. So that's a old-fashioned Colpitts oscillator, which, by the way, was a transmitter, quite efficient. I think it was a 10-20-watt oscillator, and as such, a transmitter. And this is a typical modern implementation of a Colpitts oscillator. As it is on this schematic, it's self-sufficient to make a local oscillator, maybe not a transmitter. Because in modern electronic, we want to get rid of harmonics, we want to have stability, etc., etc. This oscillator, as you see it on the left, is well working, but might not be as stable as you would like, and is going probably to produce a bunch of harmonics. But it's still very clean. It's still producing something quite narrow band and quite precise, much, much more than the spark transmitter.